hardly think as you call me, deeper still as you call me, deeper still as you call me, deeper still into love, love, love. You're a good, good father. It's who you are, it's who you are, it's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am, it's who I am, it's who I am. You're a good, good father. It's who you are, it's who you are, it's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am, it's who I am, it's who I am.
Back home again. All right. One second. Need a drink. All righty then. Let's get started with rousing discussion of church history. You're not supposed to laugh at that. Nope. But I have a PowerPoint. So who's the real ding-a-ling then, huh? The one who can't remember to print the things out or the one who can't remember to bring it? No, I meant it was me because I didn't bring it. Forgot to print it. All right, so I know you're going to have to do this again, I guess. So let's click all the way forward to slide number nine, I think. I don't know. Oh, you don't see? How did the church go wrong? That's the top one. So while he's thumbing through trying to find that one, yeah, there you go. Woo! All right, we'll stop right there. So we had been looking at the history of the church, and we started the last time looking at some of the leadership in the church and how that developed over time. And we spent quite a bit of time talking about deacons and deaconesses in particular, really trying to nail that down for us moving forward as to why we believe deaconesses are appropriate. And so we think we're good with that. So along the way, though, we had a discussion about elders as well. And we noted that with both deacons and elders, over time, the church started to get some things wrong, right? They limited the scope of the deacons. They redefined deacon to be just kind of a stepping stone position. So if you wanted to be a pastor, you have to become a deacon first, and then you work your way up from there. So they really kind of downplayed the role of deacon and put it in as just a mere stepping stone. With the role of elder, they overemphasized the elder and started to give more authority there. And before long, elders and bishops of certain cities started to influence other cities, and more people started to look to the individuals that were leading these churches and built them up. So things start to go sideways in the church in some ways very early on. And I want to ask you the question, before we pull them up on here, why, or this question, how did it go wrong? What would have been the reason behind such an early departure from some of what we would consider maybe some basic biblical truths? What would you say? What would cause the church so early on to stray away in some of these doctrines? What might cause such a thing? Okay, pride of men. Someone said disagreements. There were some disagreements that were going on. We'll talk a little bit more about those in a little bit. Pressures from the outside culture, right? Influences. We'll talk about that a little bit too as we go forward. All kinds of reasons as to why this would have happened, but here's one thing that it tells us and one thing that it reminds us. Number one on here, that only Christ is infallible, right? There are no leaders in the church who are infallible. We have individuals that we enjoy listening to. I have a list of guys that I enjoy listening to, pastors that I feel like I am taught from, authors or schools, but only Christ is infallible. Number two, another issue that comes up and is going to have particular relevance for our lesson today is that the early church did not always have the clear guidance of Scripture. And I want to be clear about this for a couple of reasons. Number one, they had a very limited number of copies of Scripture. Not everybody could have a copy, right? Not everyone had a scroll of the Bible that they could take home with them. Not until the Gutenberg Press comes along is the Bible able to be mass-produced in such a way that everyone is, it's much easier for people to have their own copies. So there's a limited number of people who can actually see. Now, on top of that, there's limited literacy. Not everybody could read. Literacy was fairly low, and so even those who did have copies couldn't always read it. And on top of that, the questions about the canon of Scripture was still being circulated, still wondering which of these books belong, which are the infallible Word of God, and which are not. And third, the point that Ellie brought up, many parts of the culture, the intellectual, the spiritual, the moral, were negative influence, and they began to have a negative influence on the church. And so now the church has to figure out how do we respond to these things. These are very much, the letter C in particular, very much an issue that we deal with today still. Right? There's negative impact to the culture. We see the impact of the culture infiltrate the church. And over the last couple decades, it's infiltrated the church. The church has kind of bought the idea that we should be run as a marketing campaign, that we should take strategies from business or strategies from our economy and implement them in the church, and we begin to trust those things over the gospel. The culture has had its influence, and it had its influence in the early centuries of the church as well. Which brings us to a discussion about the church fathers. So we have the early letters that were written by the apostles. We have the documents. We have the Scripture. We talked about the canon and how that came to be, but challenges arise, and so how do we maintain that faith? How did we hold true? How were things brought together? And we have a lot to consider amongst these guys called church fathers. Now, these guys are people who are labeled church fathers are labeled this way because they come after the death of the apostles, right? So you have the apostles. Then you have these guys that come on the scene after they pass away, and they emerge as the new leaders of the church. And they have tremendous influence over the development of doctrine and practice in the church. And because of that, they're referred to as fathers. And what we're going to do is take a brief look at a number of them, all right? So bear with us. We're going to get names this morning. I want you to become familiar with some of these names. We need to be familiar with some of these names because this is where our heritage as Christians traces to. So first of all, we have a group of individuals called the Apostolic Fathers. They're called this because they had direct contact with an apostle at some point. So some of them even trained by an apostle. Three men fit into this category: Clement, Ignatius, and Polycarp. These are individuals who knew one or more of the apostles and sat under some of their teaching and their training. So let's talk about Clement of Rome first. Clement of Rome, not certain that we know he was a direct follower of one of the apostles, but he was the bishop of the Church of Rome towards the end of the first century. So somewhere very shortly after the book of Acts would have been written, this man Clement takes over as the leader of the church at Rome. This would have been after. Yep, after. So yeah, to put things in kind of a timeline, the destruction of the temple takes place in AD 70. Clement of Rome would have risen to power as bishop in Rome somewhere the end of that century. So think 95 AD, towards the early part of the second century. So very close to the time of Christ. There is a Clement mentioned in the book of Philippians. Philippians chapter 4, verse 3 says, "Yes, I ask you also, true companion, help these women who have labored side by side with me in the gospel, together with Clement and the rest of my fellow workers whose names are in the book of life." And there's a fair number of scholars who believe that Paul is referencing this Clement, who becomes the bishop of Rome after Paul's execution. He steps in to take over leadership of the church in Rome. He's also mentioned by another guy whose name is going to come up in a little bit. His name is Tertullian. Tertullian writes that Clement knew Peter, had a relationship with the apostle Peter, though we don't know that for certain. Of the things that Clement did, we have one piece of writing that still exists from Clement, and that is a book called First Clement. First, I know, right? Go figure. First Clement. First Clement is a book that was written to the church at Corinth. So again, you kind of see the apostolic influence here, where the apostles, with their authority and their leadership, they would write to churches in different locations. They would write books of encouragement, books of instruction. So here's Clement following in their footsteps, writing a book to the church at Corinth. And in this book, he emphasizes a few things that we're going to be familiar with. Respect the authority of the elders of the church, right? We know that from the book of Hebrews, right? Strive to live in unity, which sounds an awful lot like the book of Ephesians. Remember, you are justified in Christ. These are kind of the three main doctrinal thrusts of the book of First Clement. So he writes this, "And we too, being called by his will, in Christ Jesus, are not justified by ourselves, nor by our own wisdom, or understanding, or godliness, or works which we have wrought in holiness of heart, but by that faith through which, from the beginning, Almighty God has justified all men, to whom be glory forever and ever." Clement sharing the gospel, the good news that we are justified not by works, but by faith in Christ alone. Ignatius of Antioch is our apostolic father number two, Ignatius of Antioch. Ignatius was the bishop of the church in Antioch sometime early in the second century. So when the numbers roll over to, 100 AD, that's considered the second century. So sometime early in the 100s, he becomes an elder, or the elder, at the Church of Antioch. What else do we know of the Church of Antioch, by the way, from the Scripture? Okay, that's where Christians first given the name Christian. They're first called Christians at Antioch, according to the book of Acts. Antioch is also the church that sends out Paul and Barnabas, the two individuals we talked about today, strike up quite a friendship and go into ministry together, and they are sent out as missionaries from the church at Antioch. So Ignatius, coming shortly after the time period of Saul and Barnabas, becomes the pastor, the bishop at the church at Antioch. He probably knew John. Decent chance he knew Paul, since Paul was sent out of Antioch. But some of the correspondence that we have, some of the writings that we have, seems to indicate that he had a relationship with the Apostle John as well. He wrote back and forth with Polycarp, the other of the church fathers we're going to talk about, or the apostolic fathers. It's coming up here in just a minute. Polycarp did have a relationship with the Apostle John. So there's quite a good chance that because Polycarp's relationship with John and Ignatius had a relationship with Polycarp, that those individuals knew each other as well. We don't know much about this man, Ignatius. What we do know is contained in seven letters that he wrote to different churches. Now, again, when you hear of a church father writing seven letters to various churches, anything particular come to mind? Like, does that remind you of any scripture? Maybe from Revelation, right? Where Jesus tells John to write letters to these seven churches. Here is Ignatius, who likely knew John, writing his own seven letters to seven different churches. In one of these letters, Ignatius writes this: "When you meet frequently, the powers of Satan are confounded, and in the face of your corporate faiths, his maleficence crumbles." What is this early apostolic father encouraging us to do? Meet together, right? Meet together. Sounding an awful lot like Hebrews again, right? Do not forsake assembling yourselves together. There is benefit. There is encouragement. Even in the face of satanic attack and temptation when we gather together. He is ultimately arrested by Emperor Trajan, who brings him to Rome during a persecution. When he gets to Rome, he stands trial. He told the church there to not do anything that might interfere with his execution, right? He was committed to this idea of being a martyr. And he says this, AD 117, he is sentenced to be torn apart by lions, and he's given a last opportunity to speak, and this is what the record we have of his speech. He says, "Fire, cross, beast fighting, hacking and quartering, splintering of bone and mangling of limb, even the pulverizing of my entire body. Let every horrid and diabolical torment come upon me, provided only that I can win my way to Christ." Quite a testimony. And he was torn apart by lions in AD 117. Which brings us to the last of the apostolic fathers, and by the name of Polycarp. Polycarp, who was in Smyrna, Smyrna being one of the seven churches that John writes his letter to in the book of Revelation. Ignatius wrote one of his letters to Smyrna as well, to Polycarp. Polycarp was a disciple of the Apostle John, and there's actually a fairly decent amount of material that Polycarp writes about John. He actually writes, tells a story about John who enters into a synagogue one day to pray, and in the synagogue there is a man who was a known blasphemer of Christ, and Polycarp says that John burst out of the doors of the synagogue and said, "I cannot pray with this individual in attendance with me." And Polycarp said that John left and went to pray on his own, and he records other stories, extra-biblical stories about John as well. So he had a relationship. He was a disciple of the Apostle John. He is also martyred. We actually read some of the story of his martyrdom a few weeks ago. So all three of these early church fathers, a known connection with apostles, and ultimately martyred for their faith. Now, from the time of the apostles, the church began to wrestle with different challenges that were arising from their culture, and some even from within the church itself, questions about doctrine and practice. And many of the church fathers then, after the time of these apostolic fathers, so you have these guys who were directly connected to the apostle, but now we move on a generation beyond that. We're losing connection with the apostles directly. There's conversations about which of the letters should be included in the canon, and all of these things are starting to come together. And in the midst of this fledgling church now, challenges start to arise, questions start to come up. And there is a group of individuals who are now raised up, I believe, by God to defend the Christian faith in some ways. They became known as the apologists for the faith. They put effort into considering intellectual arguments for Christianity in the face of the variety of options that were given by their culture. So if you think back in Acts chapter 17, verse 21, Paul goes to Athens, And in Athens, Paul says, now all the Athenians and the strangers visiting there used to spend their time in nothing other than telling or hearing something new. In other words, this ancient world was captivated by the thought of new philosophies or different theories, and they were easily swayed by these ideas, really a lot like our culture today, right? And much of the challenges that rested on the church was whether or not and to what degree these other philosophies could be considered Christian. So you have ideas like Epicureanism. You have the Stoics. You have those who followed Plato and those who followed the teachings of Aristotle. You have the Gnostics. You have mystics and just about every other flavor of religion and philosophy you can imagine. And so there are questions of, well, what can we take from Aristotle? Can we blend the two? It's this idea of syncretism. Does Christianity fit with these? They're all the same. I had a conversation with someone this past week, different than the conversation I told you about earlier. This woman claimed to be a metaphysicist, which I always have to stop and like, okay, what exactly do you believe again? Because they don't really believe anything. They believe everything, and in believing everything, they don't believe anything, right? They believe in what they call like meta-narrative. So she was telling me that how she believed that the Quran and the Old Testament were identical, the same God, and you know, Buddha and Allah, everything is just, it's all one big giant story. It doesn't matter what you call him. It's Heavenly Father, and it's the goddess Mother Earth, and everyone's going to be okay. We just do the best we can. It's syncretism, right? It's attempts to blend together these different ideas. So this was a pressure. This was an issue that arose even in the early church. And many of these things rose up inside the church. Gnosticism was something that grew up inside the church. How do we deal with the beliefs of Gnostics who are looking at the scripture and claiming certain things to be true that we didn't get from the apostles or from the apostolic fathers? How do we answer these challenges that come to the faith? This is where these men called the apologetic fathers come into play. The first one on our list is a man by the name of Justin Martyr. Justin Martyr might be the most well-known of the individuals on this list, maybe, partly because of his name. Just hard to forget, a guy whose last name is Martyr, who does, in fact, end up being martyred for his faith. Justin began life as a pagan philosopher. This was his lot in life. It's what he did. By his own testimony, he says that one day he was meditating along the seashore, probably in Ephesus. A stranger approached him and started to share the gospel. And in sharing the gospel, he pointed out the faults in Justin's philosophy. In other words, he was able to look at Justin's philosophical thinking and this thing that he himself was learning and teaching and go, well, Here are some faults. Here are some ways that your philosophy doesn't quite add up or doesn't quite answer some really big, important questions. Justin, on being faced with these questions that he couldn't reconcile in his own mind, and also having witnessed the death of Christians under the persecution that Rome was bringing and how they held fast to the faith, their strength under persecution and even martyrdom, ultimately is converted to Christianity. And so now he turns his attention to how can I prove the truth of Christianity against Greek philosophy, right? Greek philosophy was the predominant philosophy of the day. How can I demonstrate that Christianity is true and Greek philosophy is not? And so what he did was he focused on Christ as being the Logos. Now, where does that come from in Scripture? It's John, right? In John chapter 1, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. That word, Word, is the Greek word logos, okay, Word. So Justin argued that Christ fulfilled all of these incomplete notions of Greek philosophy. He is the logos. Logos was a word that Plato used in his philosophy. It was an idea in Greek philosophy there's kind of this divine word out there. Justin argued that Jesus was the answer that you have been seeking for. He is the divine logos, the divine word from God. And he taught that because pagan gods were created in man's image, they were inadequate. They're infantile. They're not gods. They're created in our image. We want a God who creates in his image, not the other way around. Only the God of the Bible, he argued, reigned supreme as all-wise, perfect, powerful, and good. One quote here about Justin Martyr says, though he did much to defend the faith. I jumped down. All right, Justin Martyr, right? Justin does eventually become a martyr in 165 AD. He's beheaded in Rome. Probably, if we believe history here, probably after he had bested a pagan philosopher in an open debate. So he had been in a debate with a pagan philosopher. He corners this philosopher, and in response, they beheaded Justin for his beliefs. Next, we have Irenaeus. Irenaeus was a prominent leader in the West. Irenaeus studied under Polycarp, one of the apostolic fathers that knew the Apostle John. So we see this descendant of faith here. He becomes the bishop of the church at Lyon in Gaul, modern-day France, around 177 AD. Irenaeus directed most of his writings towards arguing against Gnosticism. And so he writes much about it. He put a lot of thought into it, and he really comes down to what... let me go back to this. What is Gnosticism, by the way, before we get into his arguments against it? What is Gnosticism? Okay, physical and spiritual are separate. Physical is always bad. Spiritual is always good, right? So the two are distinct and separate. What else do we know about Gnosticism? That part of Gnosticism still kind of persists in certain Christian language today sometimes. The other thing about Gnosticism, and it's about secret knowledge. There's some secret out there. And again, this idea persists today too. There's people coming through the Bible and trying to find the secret codes. Gnosticism is really kind of the birthplace of that idea. There is secret, hidden knowledge out there. Gnosis, it's where they get the word or the term Gnosticism. Gnosis, knowledge. And only a certain few can attain to this knowledge. Irenaeus writes of Gnosticism. He says, by transferring passages and dressing them up anew and making one thing out of another, they succeed in deluding many through their wickedness and in adopting the oracles of the Lord to their own opinions. In other words, he points out that what Gnosticism is doing is taking passages in the Scripture and twisting them to mean something they were never intended to mean. Irenaeus points out this fault. He writes, really kind of his most well-known work is a book called Against Heresies. Against Heresies. And he has two main arguments against Gnosticism in this book. Number one, he says the canon of Scripture is the rule of truth. Right? We've gotten this Scripture handed down from the apostles. It's now preserved in the church, and the Scripture interprets Scripture. So long before the Reformation in the 1500s, where we get the Latin term sola scriptura, Scripture alone, we have Irenaeus saying Scripture must interpret Scripture. We cannot just take a passage out of its context and make it mean whatever we want it to mean, right? We have to interpret Scripture in light of all of Scripture, and it will tell us what it means. His second argument was that flesh cannot be evil, right? Physical cannot be evil. And his argument is that it cannot be evil because history itself culminated in God taking on human flesh and dwelling on earth, right? So if God, the Spirit, takes upon himself human flesh, and God cannot sin, then a physical body, physical flesh, cannot be sinful, right? There is no distinction in that matter or in that manner. So Ignatius gives us these really important arguments for why Gnosticism and some of their beliefs that still persist cannot be true, cannot be Christian. Tertullian was the bishop of Carthage, a city in the west of the Roman Empire. He was a very eloquent lawyer. He developed a lot of the language that we still use today in Christian theology. For example, he was the first person that we know to use the word Trinitas, or Trinity, to refer to the nature of God as being of one substance yet three persons, right? He was the first person to kind of verbalize that and put it in language. His masterpiece was a writing called Apology, the Apology. He wrote it specifically for Roman officials to read. And in it, he used very precise language to argue why Christianity should be tolerated in the Roman Empire. He rejected the idea that ancient philosophy should be mingled with Christianity. He wrote the phrase, "What hath Athens to do with Jerusalem?" Right? Christianity and philosophy cannot mingle. He coined the phrase, and I know you've heard this one, he coined the phrase, "The blood of the martyrs is the seed of the church." This was Irenaeus. Also shows a little bit of humor. He says, "If the Tiber rises too high or the Nile too low, the cry is, the Christians to the lion." Really? All of them to a single lion? In other words, he was pointing out the fact that anytime anything bad happened in the Roman Empire, they tended to blame the Christians. We need to put the Christians to death. It's their fault. And he twisted it with a bit of humor. One downside with Irenaeus, though he was wise and wrote a lot of things that are very helpful for us still to today, around 222 AD, Tertullian joined himself with the Montanists, who we mentioned a couple weeks ago as believing that they were the culmination of history, that they had special revelation and that the Spirit of God spoke through them still. So Tertullian kind of becomes this kind of hard to handle. On the one hand, we're really grateful for his defense of the faith, but on the other, he's a great reminder that we should never put too much faith in man, that only Christ is infallible, even these early church leaders. Clement of Alexandria, not the same as Clement of Rome, different Clement. This guy was influenced a lot by Justin. He was really, he's best known for trying to, he produced the idea of purgatory. So the Roman Catholic teaching today of purgatory, what is purgatory, by the way? What is that teaching? Yeah, it's like a holdover place. Like when we die, we don't go right to heaven. We have to go to purgatory until I, you know, kind of spend off all of my sin and have reached a state of perfection so that I can enter into the presence of God. Clement of Alexandria was the first one to kind of put together this idea. He invented the notion of purgatory, and that exists to today. Clement read the scripture as more allegorical than literal. In other words, when you read the Bible as an allegory, you can kind of insert all kinds of meanings in there behind the stories and what's really going on. I think many scholars believe that this is the reason why Clement of Alexandria seems to be weaker in his theology, is because he was not committed to the literal interpretation of the scripture. And so it opened him up to a lot of different error. What are y'all laughing at? He's still in purgatory. That's why we list it that way. He's not fully dead. Whatever. I don't even know what that was supposed to be. 202, I suppose, probably, is more like it. All right. Origen. Origen is an interesting character. Origen was a disciple of Clement. So, again, we're still getting this this succession. Origen was born in Alexandria in Egypt in about 185 A.D. Origen was a brilliant scholar. He is the most prolific writer of the early church period. He wrote over 2,000 pieces of work. That's a lot. Okay, he had a lot of things to say. He was one of the greatest, perhaps, Bible masters that we know of. His greatest work, he produced one of the most impressive scholarly Bible works in his day. It's a work called the Hexapla. It was the Hebrew Old Testament put in parallel with five different Greek translations of that Hebrew Old Testament. So have you ever seen a parallel Bible? You know what I'm talking about when I say parallel Bible? You get the different versions, and they list the verses side by side so you can see how they line up. He did this with the Hebrew Old Testament and translated it into five different Greek versions, or used five different Greek versions, put them all together. An impressive, impressive piece of work. He made the first effort to present the fundamental doctrines of Christianity in a systematic form. So if you ever hear someone talk about systematic theology, what are we talking about? What is systematic theology? Okay, yeah, kind of step-by-step through the truths. It's kind of categorizing the truths of the Scripture into categories, right? So we can have the doctrine of God, and let's talk about what God is and what God is like. Or we can have the doctrine of sin, and let's talk about sin, and we just take everything the Bible has to say about these different topics, and we kind of coalesce them together, right? That's systematic theology. Origen was the first individual to undertake that kind of a work, which you can imagine how much effort it would be and how much Bible knowledge you have to pull together everything the Bible has to say about Jesus or about salvation. Origen was the first to undertake such a work. He made great attempts to present the truths of Christianity in the language of the prevailing philosophy of the day. And again, here's where we get into a little bit of trouble with Origen, because he was had such an affinity with the works of Plato, it started to lead him astray in some of his thinking. And eventually, the church itself condemned Origen for his beliefs in the pre-existence of souls, reincarnation, and universal salvation. And here again, the influence of the age creeps into an individual who was greatly used by God in many ways to defend the truths of the faith. Origen was also very well known for his lifestyle. He was very ascetic. That means you're willing to restrict yourself from pleasure. And if we're to believe history again, Origen was so committed to this life of asceticism that he performed self-castration. Yeah. You know why? Because of Matthew 19, verse 12. Matthew 19, verse 12 says, "For there are eunuchs who have been so from birth, and there are eunuchs who have been made eunuchs by men, and there are eunuchs who have been made who made themselves eunuchs for the sake of the kingdom of heaven. Let the one who is able to receive this receive it." And so Origen took that very literally and made himself a eunuch for the kingdom of heaven, not understanding that that's not at all what the intention of that verse was. Some of you are able to be single your entire life. Please don't go try that at home. All right. Origen died in AD 254 under the persecution of Emperor Decius after being stretched out on a torture rack. Last but not least, Cyprian of Carthage. Cyprian was another Western church leader. He was a wealthy and influential citizen of Carthage when he became a Christian in AD 246. Cyprian came to place a lot of emphasis on the unity and the authority of the church. And he was the first one to describe the office of the Bishop of Rome as the chair of Peter. Now, who would describe the office of the Bishop of Rome as the chair of Peter today? The Roman Catholic Church, right? So Cyprian is the first person to name this Bishop of Rome or this position and to thrust all kinds of authority on this one individual. Whoever happened to hold the seat of the Bishop of Rome held the chair of Peter, and therefore the power of apostolic succession, and is therefore de facto leader of the church to whom all others should kind of bend to his authority. During the persecution of Decius, Cyprian opposed those who felt that Christians who gave in under the pressure, you know, they were being asked to recant Christ, and some did. And Cyprian said, if you recanted Christ, you have no part in the church after that. There is no restoring you to the church. He wrote a book, maybe his most well-known work, called The Unity of the Catholic Church. And he famously proclaimed, there is no salvation outside the church. So we see in Cyprian some of the formulation of these ideas that would eventually grow into what we know today as Roman Catholicism. Why do we bring up all these guys? It's a ton of names. Our heads start spinning. We're going, I can't keep Origins straight from Cyprian and Tertullian and all these guys that maybe we've never even heard of before. Why bother? Why is it important for us to know who these individuals are and even some of what their contributions were to the church? John chapter 14, 18, Jesus says, I will not leave you as orphans. I'm going away, but I will not leave you as orphans. And in his place, he gave us his word, he gave us his spirit, and he gave us his church. He made us part of his body, and we should realize the importance the corporate body of Christ has played in preserving and handing down to us biblical truth. And we should praise God for his providence in guiding the church through such times. All of these challenges that have arisen from the very earliest days of Christianity, and yet we still possess the truth. It's been handed down to us from age after age after age. Even though some of the scripture's most staunch defenders ended up in some pretty grave errors themselves. God's word has been preserved. And we must always place our faith in his word. We must always place our faith in Christ and not other Christians, as helpful as they might be at times, as brilliant as they might be, as scholarly as they may be. Our faith is in the Lord and not in another believer. It is sola scriptura. The scripture stands alone as the ultimate authority for our faith and practice. Well, listen, that doesn't mean we don't read other religious books or we don't study our heritage in the church. What it does mean is that none of those things stand above the truth as it is revealed in scripture. There is no church, there is no pastor, there is no theologian or scholar. There is no angel from heaven who has authority to alter what God has already revealed to us in his word. It is the treasure we possess, but it is a treasure that has been handed down through the ages, through the church. And we can thank the Lord for that. Any questions? Talk to me. Yeah, talk to me. He can probably do it too because I've shared it with him. I think, did I share that with you already? It will. Yeah, so I think I shared, did I share the slideshow with you or what did I share? I don't remember. I shared something with you. Was it the sheet? Okay. It's probably on there. Check that sheet. If it's not, because I updated that sheet. So if you have access to that sheet, and if anyone else, if you would like access, you want to go back and kind of read through some of these things and familiarize yourself with these individuals a little bit more. We're scratching the surface, right? I mean, we're just scratching the surface here, which makes this difficult, I know. Some of you are like, check out after about three names. Others are like, oh my goodness, I want to dig more and find out more. Wherever you may be on the spectrum, fine, okay, good. But hopefully it's an encouragement to you to look back at this history of the church. Most of them were not Jews. Yeah, the majority of them were non-Jews. Right. So you begin to understand as the gospel spreads out into the culture, the broader culture of the Roman Empire, it's meeting these different faiths and these different philosophies, and so there's just this collision that happens, and we're familiar with that, right? Everyone you talk to comes with their own worldview. We're unique in the United States; like all the worldviews come here. And you can run into all of them and see how Christian thinking collides with these ideas. And I think we're all familiar with it. We look at someone like Origen and go, oh man, how can you end up just trying to syncretize the things that you did? How can you give in to some of those things? But we all know when you're standing face to face with someone and you're sharing the gospel and their worldview collides with your worldview, we know what the temptation is. To try and maybe syncretize a little bit, to try and maybe soften the blow of Christianity, to not want to offend people or turn them off. We know what that is. It's just these individuals were on such a prominent stage in world history and in their position as leaders in the church that their errors are quite well known and had quite an impact. And so they're passed down to us even today. Next week, Lord willing, I think we'll get into a portion of history that's a little bit more interesting probably for many of you, and that's going to have to do with, something. It's going to be great. you know it's time to go, right? The Nicene Creed and the events surrounding the putting together of that creed, the Christianizing of the Roman Empire is what we're going to come to next week, and I think it's going to—you'll find it really, really interesting. It's fascinating, and it's really, really relevant because the events that happened in the early part or the mid part of the fourth century in the Roman Catholic Church or in the Roman Empire are being brought up today as challenges against the validity of some of the Christian claims and some of our doctrines. So, those doctrines will come under direct fire next week, and we need to know about this Nicene Creed and what happened around it so that we can answer some of those critics. Another question? Well, yeah. So I think every individual is going to be different. So you got an individual like we talked about here, Tertullian, I think it was. It was like, don't even try to stop my martyrdom, right? Like, I'm going, I'm going all the way to the death with this thing. But you have someone like Paul in Acts, and they're lowering him down the wall in a basket so he can escape. So I think a couple of things. Number one, I don't think we can ever point the finger at someone and say you should have done this, right? You should have stayed and faced the persecution, or you should have left and got out. I don't have that kind of authority, man. God is leading his people and directing his people. But all through, there are times where the church grows and the growth is noticeable, and there are times where it seems to go underground for a while, and maybe the growth is stymied. So through periods of history, different persecutions, the growth of the church is up and down. But at the end of the day, Christ's church is not stopped. Much like in modern China today, the church is underground. It's not meeting out in the open, but the church is exploding, and it is growing like crazy. So, sure. That's a good question, and it was varied. I think a lot of them hadn't given a ton of thought to eschatology yet. I think they were very much given to the defense of the faith. And I do think in the early part of the first and second century, very much like Paul, I think their eschatology was Jesus is coming at any moment, right? Like, I think they expected Jesus was coming very, very soon. So it certainly is not as well developed as we find eschatological thinking today. All right, let's pray. We'll get you all out of here. Father, thank you for these men and I know many women as well through history that you have used to preserve the truths that we hold so dear today. Lord, we come out of a study like this, though, and we pray that you would protect us from error. Help us to always be reliant on the Scripture. Teach us from your word. And Lord, at the same time, to love and to appreciate the heritage that we possess. Lord, may we be faithful to your word. We ask in Jesus' name, amen. All right. Thank you all. You are dismissed.